Hi, I'm Cordelia Anderson. I am the author of The Impact of Pornography on Children, Youth, and Culture, and I'm very pleased to be part of NERI's Prevention for Professionals. Part of that is because for decades in my career, I have been advocating for prevention. What are all the things that we can do to invest in the healthy development of children and youth, to change the environment so that there's not so many things that are going to make it toxic for them, or barriers and trauma that they're going to have to overcome? In fact, what can we do as individuals and as a culture and as caring professionals to change those odds so that they don't have so much to overcome? We are increasingly seeing more children and youth with problematic and harmful sexual behaviors. And you know, we're asking and looking at, is this just something we didn't see before? We used to think that if a young child exhibited some of the behaviors that we're seeing now that are harmful to self or harmful to others, that it was because they themselves had been sexually abused or traumatized in some way. And yet now we know that there's another way they could have got the ideas and got the information, and that is today's internet pornography. In fact, as adults, I've heard many say, men and women, that they're very glad they didn't have the early, easy access to the ever-increasing sexually exploitive content that is today's pornography, that they recognize that would have been really difficult for them. And yet that is the reality for our children and youth, that they have that ease of access to what is arguably not really content about sex, but sexual exploitation and degradation and violence called sex. So it's a very toxic stew of multiple points of stimulation, not like magazines. And by the way, those magazines were hidden somewhere. You understood as a child that they weren't meant for your eyes. And the stimulation from that image is certainly powerful, but not nearly as powerful as the sights and sounds of multiple videos with an ease of access to content that plays on our curiosity, plays on that novelty for something more and different, are that natural curiosity about sex, that at a time when we should have been learning about hugging, kissing, holding hands, simple relationships, what's happening in our body when we're experiencing arousal, what does love mean? Instead of really getting at all of that, they have the vast exploitive content filled with lies about race, about gender, about what sex really is. That is today's pornography. So what is it that we most need to know? I think certainly for some of us, like myself, I was trained that pornography is harmless. It's simply sex. And in fact, as a not biased, non-judgmental professional, it was important for me to recognize that this was just a sexual aid and not even question it. Then over the years, and particularly with the internet and the emerging research, we started to see that indeed there is a whole pornography industry that has been defining and hijacking the sexual narrative in many different ways. And more research that shows the harm, especially at younger and younger ages when there's no counter narrative to help our young people make meaning of this. One of the key pieces of information that has changed our understanding of the impact is the impact on the brain. Certainly just internet time generally, we've seen various studies showing, you know, our time on screen is wonderful way that we get training, we get information, that we can link with others. But when that is taking away from actual time, developing real relationships, real connections, or even giving a balance to that, getting us up and moving and away from screens, out to nature and with people, there's problems. Then you add the content of pornography when no one is really talking to our children about sex and sexuality except the pornography industry, who is in it for their profit, not for our health and well-being. So the impact on the brain, though, gives us a whole different idea of the impact on health beyond the issues of content in pornography. And that is that the way our brain works, we are drawn into that novelty. The reality of watching pornography on the internet means that there's a spike in dopamine and other feel-good chemicals that makes it very difficult to achieve with a real live human being. And there's that kind of toxic stew of, I'm shocked, I might even be anxious, I might even be appalled, and at the same time, I'm aroused. And that can be confusing for an adult. It especially is confusing for our children and youth. And then there's the mirror cells that make it seem like I am actually experiencing this thing in my body, in my mind, in my heart, and yet all I'm doing is watching it. And then there's the fact that we're drawn into, hooked into, some would say, the novelty of the difference, the way that this plays on our reward system, that actually studies are showing is changing the actual gray matter in the brain. So part of what our concern is about pornography is not only the social, relational, emotional impact, but the developmental impact on our brain. There's also great hope that that can be changed when we stop the toxic input. A really simple way to say this is that whatever we do a lot of, we get good at. So if what we want is to learn about sex and sexuality and relationships, we want to have a better understanding of our own identity and who we are as sexual beings. But the only way we're learning about that and the primary way we're experiencing that is through pornography. Go back to the brain science that helps us understand that whatever we do a lot of, we get good at. And pornography is not helping us to get good at understanding who we are in terms of our gender, our identity, or how to have healthy, nurturing, and caring relationships. Now, if you want to have discussions about this, I really encourage that, because really one of the best things we can do as caring professionals is to not let the pornography industry be the prime sex education for our children. We need to be raising this. We need to be discussing it. We need to be providing another narrative. Like a lot of other things, we need to help set limits to the toxic exposure. And we can help our kids by talking about love, by talking about intimacy, by talking about the importance of caring connections, of actually knowing what we want and what a potential partner wants. And we can help them understand that there really is a health risk and a risk on our developing brains by what it is we're putting into them. In this case, the toxic material that is pornography. So that's why, one of the many reasons why we want to limit that content. There's a lot of help for you, for professionals that want to talk about this, that give you all the citations to the research, like the National Center on Sexual Exploitation that has a wonderful compilation of research, Your Brain on Pornography, excellent compilation of research, Culture Reframed, great programs for professionals, for parents, links to resources, and Fight the New Drug, that has materials on how this affects our hearts, our brains, and our world. So be the difference with these young people. You can make a huge difference by just talking about this. Even if they haven't watched it, they're affected by other people who have, who are using the language and have the expectations of pornography. We need to counter that with love, with caring, and with possibilities for real human connection. Thank you for all you do.